Now we will establish the DFA constructed from epsilon NFA using modified subset construction procedure is indeed correct. To show that, we have to prove the theorem, which states like this. A language L is accepted by some epsilon NFA if and only if L is accepted by some DFA. Since this is a way of stating the theorem using if and only if, we have to prove in both the direction, the if part and the only if part. What is the if part? If L is a language accepted by some DFA, then there is a language L accepted by some epsilon NFA. So this is actually the DFA to epsilon NFA conversion. So in this conversion, DFA is given. Let's assume that DFA to be D with finite set of states Q, finite set of input symbol sigma, finite set of transitions delta D, starting state Q naught, and a finite set of accepting states. Now we have to construct equivalent epsilon NFA from this D. So the epsilon NFA will have the same set of states as that of the DFA, and the input symbols are going to be the same. So the sigma is same. Delta D we have to change according to the transitions of epsilon NFA. So if there is a transition from state Q to P upon the input symbol A in DFA, the equivalent transition in the epsilon NFA will be from the state Q, we transit to a set that contains the state P upon the input symbol A. Because the epsilon NFA can allow multiple transition from the same state upon the same symbol. But since this is a DFA that we are trying to convert to epsilon NFA, the DFA has a definite transition upon an input symbol from a state. So this state, set of states will have a singleton set. And since this is epsilon NFA, the epsilon NFA allows transitions on epsilon, which are null strings. And DFA do not have any transitions on null strings. So we have to add the transition for epsilon NFA from all states Q upon the null string, which is null set. This is a new state. And what is the only if part? If there is a epsilon NFA that accepts a language L, then there is a DFA that accepts the same language L. So this is nothing but so epsilon NFA to DFA conversion, which is nothing but the modified subset construction that we have already seen. So we are to construct this D, which is having the set of states QD, the input symbols, set of transitions, the initial state QD, and the set of final state FD. That has to be constructed from the epsilon NFA E with states QE and the same set of input symbols, and the transition is delta E, starting state is Q naught, and the set of final states are FE. Now we have to prove that we know this conversion procedure. Given a epsilon NFA, we know how to use the modified subset construction to construct this DFA D. Now we have to prove that the language of the DFA is equal to the language of the epsilon NFA. This we can establish by showing that if we start from the starting state of the epsilon NFA and accept an arbitrary string W, we end up in some state, and that state will be equivalent to the state we land up when we start from the state QD, which is the starting state of the DFA, and accept the same string W in the DFA. That is the extended transition function of the epsilon NFA and the extended transition function of the DFA are one and the same. This we can do it by the induction on length of W. To show that the extended transition functions of epsilon NFA and the DFA are the same, we'll see the basis. Since it is the induction on the length of W, we'll consider the trivial string with the length 0, which is nothing but W is actually the null string. Now, when we are using the epsilon NFA, sorry, this has to be E, because we are using the epsilon NFA. So the extended transition function, when we start from Q naught and accept a null string, as nothing but the E closure of, or the epsilon closure of Q naught. Because from the ENFA, when we start from Q naught, either we can stay in Q naught or we can transit to any state that is reachable from Q naught using epsilon, which is nothing but the E closure or the epsilon closure of Q naught. And what is the QD according to subset construction? QD is nothing but epsilon closure of Q naught. This is how we start with. And when we have the DFA, we do not have any transition on epsilon, and QD is nothing, is equivalent to staying in the start state. So this is also similar, right? When we have epsilon NFA, we are in the start state and we are trying to accept the epsilon. Since there is no transition upon epsilon in DFA, we remain in the same state. That is the meaning of transition from a state using epsilon in a DFA. Therefore, we have established that the delta cap of E from Q naught upon epsilon is E closure of Q naught, and QD is also, that is, when we start from QD and accept epsilon, the result is going to be QD, which is nothing but the E closure of Q naught. So we have established that the extended transition of the ENFA when we start from Q naught and accept epsilon is same as that of the extended transition of the DFA when we start with QD and accept epsilon. The induction part is, we will assume a string of length n plus 1, and we will assume that our theorem statement holds for a string with length of n. That is, the delta cap of E when starting from Q naught and accepting W will be same as that of when we start from QD and accept W in the DFA. Now we will split W as XA, where A is the final symbol of W. That is, A is a single symbol and X is rest of the symbols in W. Now we have to show that this theorem holds for this entire W, which is of length n plus 1. Since this is holding, this statement holds good for any string of length n, we know that the delta cap of Q naught comma X for a epsilon NFA will be equal to the transition when we start with QD upon X using the induction hypothesis that we have. Let's assume that this set is equal to P1, P2, etc. up to PK. That is, the transition from the starting state and accepting X has landed in a set containing this. So this will be a single state in the case of DFA, but this will be a set of states in NFA. But the nature of the set will be the same as that of this set for both NFA and DFA. Now let's see how we can make a transition for the rest of the input in the W, which is A. So from the inductive definition of the delta cap, which is the extended transition function for the epsilon NFA, we can compute the transition from Q naught upon the input string W by this one. We have started from the starting state and accepted all the symbols in the string W up to X, and we have landed in P1 to PK. And from these states, how we can accept A in the epsilon NFA is the question now. And that is what the inductive definition of the delta cap of the epsilon NFA defines. For each of the PI, we have to find what is the transition that we are making upon the input symbol A, and we have to make a union of all of them and let the set that is resulting as R1, R2, etc. up to Rm. And since this is a epsilon NFA, from each of the state there could be a transition on epsilon. So we have to find the epsilon closure of each of these states and make a union of all of them. And that is what is the result of the transition when we start from Q naught and accept W. And let's consider that this is the equation 1. In the modified subset construction, we compute the transition of the DFA given a set of states and the input symbols using the following procedure. For each of the state, we find what is the transition upon the input symbol in the epsilon NFA and make a union of all of them. This is the first step, and then we find the E closure of each of these states R1, R2, etc., Rm. Find the union of all of them. And this is how we find the transition delta D using the modified subset construction procedure. And we see that the equations 1 and 2 are one and the same. And thus we can establish that the extended transition functions of the ENFA and the DFA are landing in the same state. That means that the language of the ENFA and the DFA are one and the same. Thus, we have proved the theorem. In the next video lecture, we'll start with regular expression. Thank you for watching this video.